5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
When I had come down this hill, I had seen this creature cross the road. It would have ripped my locked door from my truck, extracted me from my vehicle, and there wouldn't have been a damn thing I could have done about it.
This thing, I got to notice in its eyes. Its eyes was real, real evil, real sinister looking. You know, the look it was giving me.
Jesus Christ, you better... Sheriff, Gia!
Hello?
Get somebody out here.
What's going on now, sir?
That son of a bitch is about 6 foot 9, I don't know.
Do you see him now, sir?
Yes, I'm looking right at him.
Uh-oh.
Welcome to Sasquatch Chronicles, a place where people share their encounters. Let's start the show. Welcome to the show, everyone. Thanks for being here tonight. Got a great show planned for you tonight, Sunday night. How's everyone doing out there? I don't know where you guys are at, but I like to complain about the weather for 5 seconds. It's been hot here. It's been real hot. And I know you down there, you people down in the south are laughing at me, but it's hot for me up here, so back off. I'm just playing. Got a great show planned for you tonight. Going to be bringing Fabrice on. And Fabrice is actually out in England, so I think it's like 3 o'clock in the morning his time. But he's agreed to come on the show and talk about his encounters when he lived in California. So look for that here in a moment. I'll also be welcoming Duke and a gentleman we'll call Caveman. He's a respected elder in the Navajo tribe, and he's dealt with these creatures. So he'll be sharing kind of the insight of how the Native Americans feel, specifically the Navajo, towards these creatures. So look for that coming up. If you've had an encounter and you'd like to be on the show, shoot me an email. My email address is wes@sasquatchchronicles.com. I do try and read every email that comes through, but if you've had a specific encounter, it helps me if you put encounter in the subject line, and I will get back to you. I'd love to hear from you, love to hear your encounters, and that's what the show is all about. I want to wish Teresa Cruz a happy birthday. She's one of the admins on Sasquatch Chronicle fans on Facebook. Just want to wish her happy birthday. Thanks so much, Teresa, for everything that you do. I want to remind everyone too, right around the 1st of September, I'm going to have Sasquatch Chronicle shirts, beanies, all sorts of different gear for everyone. I have some of it here in my office, and I absolutely love it. I think it's cool gear to wear. The shirts are comfortable. The beanies are awesome. I'm a beanie guy. I love beanies. So look for all of that gear around September, beginning of September. I hope you guys get a chance to check it out and maybe get yourself something. Let's jump into it tonight. Fabrice, welcome to the show, man. Thanks for being here tonight. I really appreciate you coming on.
Oh, thank you very much. I'm a huge fan. Me and my girlfriend, we listen to your show every night, and it's great. I really love it.
I appreciate that. And I know it's late out there in England, but you said you had your encounter or a couple strange encounters in California. If you would kind of tell us what happened and
sure, thanks.
The experience and what you were doing.
Yeah. I was about probably like 19 or 20 when, well, actually I'll go to the first encounter. I was probably like a teenager, like 13 or 12 years old. And I used to go to see my friend all the way out in Agoura Hills. It's like ranch property. It's on the edge of civilization. I mean, there's government property where it's restricted area, and that area is just nothing but wildlife. Creeks, oak trees, you name it, like, you know, grass, like high grass, rolling hills. And the strange thing, you know, it happened a lot in the evening, actually, a lot of the stuff, banging on windows. Many, many times that's happened. And every time it happened, I always asked my friend, you know, what the hell was that? Someone just banged on a window, you know, and he said, nah, it's just the wind, you know? So I was like, okay. And I went outside and I could see some wind. It's like, okay. But then, you know, it happened again and again and again. And he always said it was the wind. And then it happened later on when we were a little bit older. And it was just me and him home. His parents weren't home. And it happened. And I looked out the window, checked if there was wind. There was no wind. And I told him, you know, there's no wind. Look out the window. And he just like had this crazy look on his face, like, okay, he's right. So we went outside. We went to take a look. And we could hear something moving in the brush. But we couldn't see because the back of the property had like a pretty high ridge. Not really high. It was only about 20, 30 feet. So it was relatively close. And on the end of the property was barbed wire fence. And on the other side of the barbed wire fence was just wild land. I mean, we used to try to go out and play there when we were kids, but it was impossible because the brush, I don't know the name of the plant, but it is so like thorny and hard, you can't even walk through it unless you get like bruised and bloody, you know. So we would hear something rustling in the back, and literally something just flew out of the air, and this was at night, and it landed right in front of us. And my friend pulled it up, and it was a pine cone. I mean, it perfectly landed right in front of us, and we just thought that was really peculiar. And we went back inside. We kind of shouted out, like, hey, you know, we got guns. If anyone's messing up with us, you know, we're not afraid to use them. And we went back inside and we just started tripping out on that kind of thing. And I never really thought of Sasquatch at the time. I was aware of it, but I didn't put it together until I actually started listening to your shows. And other experiences like finding like neat little stacks of rocks around his property. And he did have what we call floodlights, or, you know, lights that turn on automatically from motion sensors. And I do recall seeing those neatly stacked rocks. And it was really strange because where he lived was on top of the hill. You could not go up into his property unless the gate was opened. There was a barbed wire fence around the entire property. I mean, there was just no way it would have been some, like, you know, prankster or some kid. I mean, me and my buddy at that time, we were probably the biggest pranksters in the neighborhood. We were the worst kids. So, you know, we would never think of going up to someone's property past the fence, you know, and also because there's just so many, lots of police officers live in that area. You know, everyone's got guns. It just, there's no way we would have done that. So, I don't know. It was really strange. Also, something always used to pick through his garbage, and he was convinced it was coyotes. So I once noticed it and I thought, oh, someone's been digging through your trash. And he said, no, it's been coyotes. But it was really strange because the lid was nicely open. Things looked like they were picked out of the garbage can and neatly placed on top of the wall. You know, I don't know about you, but here in England, we've got foxes, which is the equivalent to coyotes. When they rummage through the trash, they tear it to pieces. You know what I mean?
Yeah, it's a mess.
It's a big mess. You know, this was like neatly placed. It was just really peculiar, you know. And once again, I just never thought it was Sasquatch. I mean, it honestly looked like a person picked up the trash out of the, you know, looking through the bin, like as if he was looking for something. But anyway, so that was in Agoura. And
did you ever go back and talk to your friend?
No.
Years later and say, hey, you remember all that not banging on windows? Because I've heard the wind go through there. I've been through the area, actually, you're talking about in California.
Oh, yeah.
It is windy, but God, you know, sometimes you get wind gusts. But you heard what you thought was banging on the window. I would imagine you would have thought, oh, okay, that's a wind. It wouldn't have really startled you if it was a wind. You know what I'm saying?
I mean, honestly, I was never convinced. When they always said it was the wind, I really was never convinced. I even heard someone banging on the wall, and the wall is made of concrete. I mean, the wind can't do that. That was really strange. And I actually seen like a print. It looked like a fist print, like something greasy or someone greasy, you know, hit the wall because their house was immaculate. You know, they really took care of the property. And to answer your first question was I never really spoke to him about it because I stopped speaking to the guy about 7 years ago because he became just a really bad alcoholic and nearly got me killed one night. And so I stopped talking to him and I only started listening to your show about a year ago. So it was only then when I really, you know, a year ago, maybe this year, I started to connect the dots. But I'll tell you, you know, other things we found, I remember finding it looked like a pile of human feces, but it was incredibly large. And it was so large, it made us laugh when we were kids. We're like, what the hell? Some homeless guy's coming out here, but there's no place to sleep or no place to live in that area because there's rattlesnakes, there's scorpions. I mean, there's just no way people would live out there. And another thing was when we were a little bit – it was around the same time when we were about 13, we went – about a mile out, and we went in, you know, to the wild part. Pretty much, there was no houses. We were being adventurous, and this was at night. We thought, oh yeah, let's go shoot some rabbits. And we had our air gun pistols. You know, they probably couldn't even puncture skin. You know, and there was a creek. We went to the area where there was actually a creek, and I took a shot at a rabbit and missed it. And all of a sudden, the entire valley just started howling at us like. It sounded like wolves, man. I know what coyotes sound like. They kind of have like a bit of a giddy laugh to their howl. Do you know what I mean? Yeah. They sound like little dogs, coyotes. I swear, it sounded like wolves, and it frightened the life out of us. And I never ran like so fast for so long. I think we ran a good 2 miles all the way up to the hill back home. It was crazy.
Now, you mentioned something that hit the side of the house, and it was concrete.
Yeah, I definitely heard that. And another thing at that house, I used to go there when I was about 10 years old because that's when they moved out there. There would be times at night when I'd wake up and I'd be absolutely paralyzed in fear. And I just was convinced something was watching me through the window. I don't know why I always felt that way. It was always in that house, in that bedroom. And it was such a struggle to actually get up to turn around and look through the window. Do you know what I mean? That paralyzing fear.
Yeah, I do.
But I never saw anything. Maybe it was nothing. I don't know. But
did the parents ever talk about it? Did they ever say what they?
No. You know, the only thing I found interesting was his father was a sheriff, a narcotics officer, undercover narcotics officer, and he was very adamant and strict to us about. Not going over to the government property. He just said, do not go there, son. Like, because we had ATCs. We can go anywhere. It was great, you know, because there was fire roads and stuff. But nah, he said, do not go there. And it actually reminds me of one night when we were maybe like 18. The parents were gone again. They used to travel a lot. And so me and my friend, we'd break out the whiskey and start drinking, enjoying our time alone in the house. And we're standing outside, just kind of looking over the canyons and the mountains and stuff, because we could see everything. And I could hear someone walking through that brush down the hill. And this was maybe, you know, about 50 feet away. It wasn't that far away. And that brush, like I said, you know, it was so thorny and so hard to get through physically as a human. You just could not do it. We've tried it, and we've come out just bleeding and scratched up. You know what I mean? Like it'd tear your clothes off. We heard someone walking. I heard someone walking through, and I had to tell my friend to shut up. And I was like, listen. And you can hear it was someone bipedal just marching through it. Like it was no problem. And it was making so much noise. It was just crunching all the way through. And I mean, what was strange was that there was a fire road just adjacent to where he was walking. He could have just taken the fire road, but this person didn't. This person walked all the way through the brush and carried on over the mountain that went over to the government property, which is just wild, wild land. If you look on Google Maps, you can see there's a road called Chesbro Road, and then it connects to another road called, I think, Fairview Place. And pretty much beyond that point, it's just wilderness up until Simi Valley, and the 118 freeway. But then once again, after that, it's just wilderness all the way through California.
I wonder if you're describing Manzanita.
Maybe. It's just rampant over there. It's everywhere. I mean, it's very...
Yeah, because I know when I had Rocky on, Rocky Elmore, he talked about the Manzanita, and I've been down there and seen it firsthand. I mean, it's hard.
Yeah.
It's impossible to get through. And he talked about it all the time. And they had their encounter in a similar area, except for farther south. And he said that this thing just walked through it like it was no problem. And the normal human just couldn't do that.
Yeah.
Just physically couldn't get through it.
Now this person was just going through it like no problem and making a hell of a lot of noise. And we started shouting at it, and there was no response. And that was that. That pretty much covers Agoura Hills. And then later on in my life, I think it was about 20, 21, me and my bass player in my band, we decided we wanted to go to this cave we knew, which was in the Topanga area. And we basically parked our car, started walking up the trail. And as we got closer to the cave, we were about maybe 20 feet away from the cave. There was – what it was is that when you get near the cave, you're actually on top of a ridge. And you have to go down a path to enter the cave, because on that ridge is once again like poison oak and that bush you're talking about, Manzanita.
Yeah, Manzanita.
So but the thing is, when we approach that ridge, we can hear voices in the cave. And we stopped and listened to it for, you know, a good 30 seconds. We actually stopped and tried to listen to what this person was talking about. And it was obviously talking to someone. I think it was one voice that we heard. It was a man. And they were speaking, this man was speaking quite gentle, but I could not understand one word this male voice was saying. And it was a very strange language. And we were only about 20, 30 feet away. You know, that's close enough to hear someone pretty much speaking. And, I should have been able to understand it. And I come from a family of French, Hungarian, Austrian. And I had like Russian music teachers when I was a kid, so I know languages. I mean, it was really strange sounding. It sounded almost backwards sounding. So me and my friend were just thinking, well, you know, we can't just go in there, you know, we have to maybe announce our presence. Maybe they're doing something, you know, shady. So we announced our presence, and the voice just stopped. So we thought, oh, great. Well, now we can't go to the cave. Okay. And then it was weird. It was like as if from the cave, something jumped maybe 20 feet. And all of a sudden, 20 feet to my left, I hear the bush, just like something landed in the bush. And it started coming up towards us, up the ridge, through this Manzanita shrub. And it was like digging its way through it. And it was bipedal. But it started making these sounds like a bad imitation of a mountain lion, you know, and it was just like, whoa, okay. And we looked at each other and we counted to three and we just ran. And once again, I was freaked out like, you know, the other time we ran and we got in the van, we drove off, and I didn't think of Sasquatch at the time, you know, but oddly enough, my friend, the bass player, Eric, he told me his experience of seeing something that sounded like a Sasquatch in a nearby area, which was a kind of foresty bit we used to go up and hang out, you know. And what he told me, what he saw, because it reminded him of that, he saw it with his friend. He said he saw a big hairy arm with like a claw-looking hand and two glowing red eyes.
Was that near that same area?
It was closer to the Mulholland Drive road, where there's like a lot of kind of just wildlife. I think it's considered the Santa Monica Mountains. I believe there's a trail that starts all the way from Mulholland Drive to all the way to the Santa Monica Mountains. And all of that area, I mean, there may be sparsely some houses, but mostly is just wild land. You know, you see deers, you see cougars, you know.
Yeah, that's weird. You would think that if it was a person in there, they would have called back to you.
Yeah.
Or said, hey, we're in here, or hey, or hello, or, you know, or even if it's, let's say, a Russian, they're going to say something back to you just as a response. It's human nature just to respond back if someone's yelling in your general direction.
Yeah, that's what we thought.
And that's interesting you say that it sounded backwards. I just spoke to a guy 3 days ago who he was hunting, and he said it sounded like a language, but like they were talking backwards. He's like, if you take like an audio track and play it backwards, he goes, that's what I heard. And he goes, but it ended up throwing rocks at this guy, and he never saw what it was. But he said, if you take an audio track, play it backwards, that's what I heard.
Yeah, like when you get a record and you just start spinning it backwards.
Right, yeah. Do you think at your friend's house, do you think he actually had – in those situations, it always amazes me because people don't want to jump to that conclusion. So they'll say it's the wind or they'll say it's
no.
– it almost makes you wonder if his dad kind of knew something was going on out there or
– I think so. I think so because he was a cop and he must have known something. I mean, there must have been reports, you know, because you know, it wasn't until I started listening to your show that I connected the dots and all these experiences and you know, the story my friend told me, said seeing the red eyes, it just made sense. It was like, gosh, you know, these things, these creatures, you know, a road isn't going to stop them. A road does not tame wildlife. You know what I mean? I mean, obviously there's so many sightings of them crossing roads anyways, but what I'm trying to say is that like a lot of people think that they're so arrogant in thinking that we've conquered all that land in America, but they don't really understand how vast the wild is and how it actually creeps into the areas of the suburbs, you know, because the suburbs are surrounded by wildlife. And I wouldn't be surprised if my friend's father knew about something, because there was actually a military base out in the middle of that area. I believe it's called Roswald. Like Roswald, and recently some information has just been published that they used to have a nuclear reactor in there and stuff. I don't know. They're just doing some dodgy stuff. I also heard it was like a missile testing plant. I don't know, but I've seen it. I've actually seen the gates. I've driven up to it with a friend of mine, and I've actually seen that military base, and it's in the middle of nowhere.
I wonder if that's the same base. Gosh, probably 200 shows ago, I had some people on from the military that were in a base out there. We're describing, and they describe it in the middle of nowhere, and they had problems with these things running in, you know, going across the, because they have ground sensors and everything, but they used to always have problems. He said and he called them apes. He said the apes would always get on the base and always run, you know, be in areas they're not supposed to be, and everyone on the base was well aware of it. I think he was a military police officer, actually. And he said everyone on the base was aware of it. They were told not to talk about it, but he said this thing would get through in areas no man could actually get into. And they just kind of run around. They chased him a couple times in the Jeeps, lighting him up, and all kinds of stuff out there.
I remember that show. Yeah, I remember that one.
Makes me wonder if it's that base you're mentioning.
You mean he didn't tell you which base it was?
He did. I think we left it off the air, but he did tell. But it was in California. And when you said Roswald, that made me stop. Because I think when him and I were talking, I said, you mean Roswell? So I think it might be the same base we're talking about, but it wasn't Roswell. It sounded like Roswell, New Mexico.
It was Roswald, yeah, with a D.
It was crazy, man. It was a crazy, crazy show.
Well, yeah. I mean, I think they can pretty much get anywhere. You know, I mean, geez, you've seen them, right? I mean, that's incredible.
Yeah, I don't think they'd have any problems getting onto a base or going through the brush you're talking about. I don't see them having any issues with that. You know, they're built different than we are. They're stronger. And you would think, though, it would hurt going through some of the brush that you hear them go through. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Well, their skin is probably callous, you know?
Fabrice, I appreciate you coming on, man, and sharing it.
Thank you for having me. And it's a pleasure speaking to you and listening to your show as well.
Thanks, Fabrice. The pleasure was all mine. Thank you so much again for coming on. Let's jump to our next guest. I want to welcome Caveman to the show. Caveman, how are you tonight?
All right, I'm good to go.
And I want to welcome a fan favorite. He's our Sasquatch Chronicles celebrity. Duke, thanks for coming on.
Always fun to be on the show with you, Wes, and hi to all your fans out there. Thanks for listening, guys.
And I'm really glad to have Caveman on the show. Obviously, it's a nickname, Caveman, but I know you're a very well-respected member of the tribal area, and I know you've kind of grown up with these creatures. You've had knowledge passed down to you regarding these creatures. Tell us about the first time you ever encountered them.
Okay. The first time was I was about maybe 5 or 6 years old. My younger brother and my older sister, we were playing in the house late at night, I'd say somewhere around 9 o'clock. Our babysitter had disappeared, and we were just tearing up the house, going back and forth from the living room to the kitchen, just playing around. And here, my brother just lets out a real big yell, cry, hey! A little like that, and pointed at the window in the kitchen. And it was the kitchen sink window that he was pointing to. And my older sister and myself, we had just touched. I think we were playing tag or who can get to a certain place real fast. And we had just touched the sink, and he was little ways back, about five feet back from us. And he pointed at the window, and we looked over there, and we couldn't really comprehend what we were looking at. And we stood there for a little while, trying to ask one another, what it was. And the thing that was looking back had the reflection of the light from the lighting from the kitchen, and the moonlight coming in from the outside. And so we could see the whole body shape, the upper body shape. And then we just kept looking at it. It had big brown eyes, kind of bloodshot eyes. And the thing that still is in my mind is that the way that it was looking at us through the sideways. But the eyes, the pupil, I should say, was slanted horizontally. And and then it comes out, I don't know what you call on the eyeball where it comes out. It was kind of like yellowish orange. And then it could see the little white, and then from there it was bloodshot. And they were like maybe half dollar size big eyes that were looking at us sideways. And so we looked at it, and they kind of, looked back at us, and we saw a real big arm, or which we thought at the time was a big trunk. And I asked my sister, what is that? We were just looking at it about 2 feet away from it, just looking up. And it was just standing there. And here she says that, that's an elephant. So, we at that time we thought it was an elephant, that roamed the night. And,
so she thought the arm dangling looked like an elephant's trunk.
Yeah. And here later on we found out it was the arm that was going across the window, holding on to the other corner, the opposite corner of the window. Yeah, we thought that it was an elephant because that at the time it was that trunk was huge.
Did you get a good look at the face?
Yeah, it was kind of like a grayish, weather-beaten face. It wasn't it was cracked, or how like a chimpanzee face is. It's all kind of lined, like all aged and all of that. It wasn't like that. It was just fine, and it was kind of gray towards white color, like dry also. That's how it was at the cheek on down, kind of like that. And then the little hairs that were coming off of it, and all it had a real big kind of like beard, and it just came all the way around the face, all on to the chin. But as further as it goes towards the eyes, it became kind of like just a regular brown, lighter color complexion. And that's how I seen the really first one. And like I said, I didn't know what it was at the time, and It didn't scare us or anything. We just didn't know what it was.
And was the creature just standing there watching you guys?
Yeah, it was motionless. It just, you know, like in a frozen state. It just, the only thing that was moving was the eyes. It would look past us, and then it would look back down on us. So I'm thinking that it was looking at my brother. The thing about it is, after that, we wanted to see what it was. You know, we wanted to see that elephant.
Go
outside, and we had opened the front door and tried to pull on it, but my sister looked up at it, and then we found out it was padlocked, you know, somewhere during all that playing that we were doing, the babysitter decided to go do something else, you know, and locked us in.
Did the creature eventually leave?
It was still there. It was still looking at us. We started to go. My sister was the one that started to comfort my younger brother. And we went back into the other the living room. And we, you know how little kids, they play like, they cover like boxes and then pretend that it's a house and all of that. And that's what we were doing. And we had laid out some little blankets and all of that. And we put them in there. We came back around and, you know, it was still there. And, you know, we tried to go outside like I said before. We tried to really pull on the door and we never made it out. It was still there. It you know, when I went to sleep, it was still there.
Well, it wouldn't be very threatened by children the size that you guys are at. You were like 5, your younger brother's 4, and your older sister was 6 or 7.
It was probably just, that's what they do. I mean, from my experience, you know, they observe you. And little kids, they like to observe them a lot.
Isn't that creepy?
Yeah, it is.
Why do you think they do that?
It's the way that I think about that is their intelligence kind of goes into, you know, like being playful, and then little kids do, you know, when they're all laughing, it sounds very cheerful when you just hear the kids playing. Those little kids laughing and all that, they give off good vibes. And then the other thing I always think about is you know, it could be dinner. That's what those are the two that I always think about.
That's the one that scares me. That option B is the one that, you know, with my first encounter when I was 10, I don't know if it was just trying to make us leave the area or if it was seriously considering us as a possible snack. You know, either way, I wasn't sticking around to find out. But, you know, that's one of the things that's always bothered me about the whole trying to find out about this whole creature and or possible more than one variety of creature and what they're up to. Because this thing of over and over and over again, seeing them, you know, showing interest in kids, and then the actual cases of missing kids that sometimes are really suspicious, you know, it sends a chill down your spine.
What does the tribal elders say about this creature? Because, you know, the Navajos were known as pretty fierce warriors, not a people you really want to mess around with. From what I've read in the past, like, and maybe you can correct me if I'm wrong, they didn't care too much for these things.
Yeah, there's a story about it that they were driven up north, and they went as far as into the next country. The way they said it, the way the elders and the songs, you see, it's in the songs also. The way that it is they were just being a nuisance out here and eating people, being in the way, and, you know, always just being bullied. They were kind of like driven all the way past. The way it is past them big trees to the north, the wooded forest. Some had escaped, but majority of it were taken all the way up to where it was really cold. so they won't return. And where this whole area is some real big mountains. And from there on, they crossed it, and they crossed, chased it into past the land, a different land, and they escaped from there in all different directions. And that's what the story is about also, and they were exiled, in other words.
Would you say that your people in general have friendly relations with them, or do you view them with suspicion? Do you think that they're potentially dangerous and, you know, potentially a problem?
It was always dangerous. It's a bad omen to have them come around your dwelling, you know, your residence. They've been known to eat people, and that was the reason why you would get them away from your house, because everybody that lived a long time ago, as the elders had said, you know, when there were no boundaries.
Let me ask you, have you dealt with any violent encounters around the reservation that you've actually looked into?
I have encountered one that was on top of the mountain that they told me to come look at. And what had happened was there was a guy that would herd sheep up in the mountains, and he had his rifle with him, a real, you know, real good big one, a T-70. And he was out there. He was a good shot. You know, he was a, you know, regular mountain man. And one night, I guess he had a confrontation, or this thing followed him home. And his relatives were the ones that called me, said that they couldn't find him. And then they also called the police. And even before I got to that place, they had found him 3 miles away with the leg missing. But the footprints right at the front door were very visible, where he was dragged out from his bed all the way out, left the door open, his wallet and his gun was still and laying there, and his wallet, his money, food, and everything. It wasn't bothered. The only thing that came out of that house was him. And the thing about it is the man had his leg was pulled off only on one side, and he bled to death. So whatever this thing is
it wasn't bitten off, and it wasn't clawed off. It was torn off.
Yeah, it was torn off. It wasn't chewed off or anything like that. It was just ripped out. And
Jesus, I bet there was a lot of blood when that happened. It must have been a pretty easy sign to find it.
Yeah, and here the black bears that we have over here are not that big, like up in the northern part, you know, in the northern states. The black bears over here are only somewhere around four feet to 3 to 4 feet. That's as big as they get. So it couldn't have been a bear. A bear would have clawed at him and probably ripped him apart right inside the house.
He'd have been ripped apart, no doubt.
Those are the different things. The thing about it is that when this thing, he was dragged out, and from there was no dragging mark all the way to where that guy laid. We already knew what it was, but you know how law enforcement is and all that. It's a bear. They just took the body, and then that was it. And then we just left it at that.
The family ever get to see the body at all?
The relatives were the only ones to go over there to identify the body.
So they didn't have like an open casket funeral or anything like that?
Not this one. And there's another one that had happened, which my buddy Brenda Harris had also investigated. And this was inside a hogan. It came inside the house. And it sat down right by right by the door, and it was trying to get swooshed out, and here it got violent and slammed that guy to the ground while there was another elderly lady that was in there. She's the one that called the cops. He was ripped up, body parts missing, you know, the legs and one leg and the arms, all ripped up.
Did the other lady manage to make it out of there?
The lady got out of there and called the police. They were still
like
arresting.
I presume while it was attacking him, she used it as, you know, it's just going to kill me in a second, I better get out of here and call the police sort of opportunity.
Yeah, and there was another resident, which was only approximate link to that next resident, was only about 100 to 100 feet. She went over there, and then she just told her neighbors to call the police. And they came over there, and the guy that I went over there with actually was at the scene, I guess. He lives about an eighth of a mile west of where it happened, and here he came up the road, got to that place, and just then the police had got to that place also. And he was interviewed, they thought that he was the one that killed the guy. We went around there after all the police, that police yellow line that they put up was all around it, and when it started to get windy and it blew away, and he took me back to that place, and then we walked inside, looked inside, and then we found blood all over.
What do you think set those creatures off?
The upper part of the innards were gone. So that creature, you can tell, if those things are gone, that creature was hungry. And they its trail was just maybe 200 feet. There's a wash. It's called like a creek, a drainage that comes off from the east and goes to the west, and the creek goes right by their house. And they said that they always say, see maybe a couple walking by or screaming or just making different noises walking through there. So the people that live along that creek, you know, at certain times, they would just go inside and just look out. In other words, when the sun is just about to go down, you go inside. That's what we were always told also.
That's the thing I've noticed about the stuff that's been going on down there so far, Caveman, is that everything is near one of these water courses where they can just be following the rivers of the little tributaries connected to them and get to all these places where this stuff has been happening at.
That's what we noticed is they walk inside what we call the wash area. They're like maybe some areas, they're like 10, 12 feet where the water had eroded into the sand. And mm-hmm. the water still trickles down through them. Some of them are dry, but these huskings, they go through there as like to be out of everybody's way.
If I understood you right, it attacked and killed these two and actually ate a portion of them. And so you're thinking these creatures were hungry?
They were hungry. The guy that was there, that his uncle, that was his uncle that it happened to. He was saying that they might have been putting out dog food for their dog, but these things, when they come by, would be thinking that they were being fed.
So they were sort of habituating them by accident. They didn't even realize that they were doing it. Leave the dog food outside and not realize something else is going to come by and eat it, and then start thinking it's their food.
People, a lot of people don't know that they do that, and
kidding. Me and Wes would both be super rich if we had 5 cents for every time we heard one of those stories where it was, you know, leaving food out for the poor little starving animals, or let's feed the dogs out on the porch all the time, or, you know, let's not be very careful about how easy it is to get at the food for the livestock. And, you know, next thing you know, and same thing with garbage containers and stuff, too. That attracts bears. It's the same sort of principle. Free food. Boom. They're there. They're opportunists.
Yeah. Let me put in one example. There's this guy that I used to work with. He, was feeding them cantaloupe rinds and watermelon. I guess he felt sorry for them. We would feed him a mile away from his house. As soon as the construction work started to go down, he got laid off. Next thing he know, we know, he comes back to tell us, hey, you know, this thing followed me home. I didn't have nothing to give them anymore, and they followed me home. One actually put their arm inside my house and grabbed a watermelon that I had. He said, that's one big mistake I told you. When you told me the first time, I told you not to do that. Mm-hmm. And they will follow you home. Don't matter, you know, if you're about 5-10 miles away, they'll follow you home. They know, you know, the sound of the vehicle,
yep,
the voices, and all of that. They know that. And, you know, the dogs, how they jump up when my wife starts to come over and coming back. Even before I could see her coming down the road, they, you know, jump up, start barking, and that'll be it. And sure enough, she comes over the road and, you know, over the hill and on the road and all that. Oh, you know, they know that. So these are huskies. They're the same way.
Okay, man, what do you think that these things are? I'm sure you got to, you know, and you don't have to give me the politically correct answer, but what, I mean, honestly, what do you think that these things are?
My own opinion or from the elders?
No, your honest opinion.
For me, they are ancient people. They've been here, living here. They've been, always been here. We started to coexist with them. And like that it says in the legend, they were already here. And that's what it says in the legend. These are the ones that, you know, the things that I'm telling you now are not in the history books.
Mm-hmm.
And not in any of the books that are there. That's the reason why they say, you know, it's a bad omen to be talking about it, to be around them, to observe them, and all of that.
Why is it a bad omen? What is it that makes it a bad omen?
Because when it comes around, it's like they pick at your things. They'll either eat your livestock, they'll try to climb in your house, they'll come in your house and pick you up, steal a child here and there, and, you know, it's just negative. You know, if you get a visitor, anybody else knows, and in this society that we live, you know, when you have a visitor, then that visitor says hello and tries to be nice and have manners. But this thing, when it comes around at night, it don't have manners. It just decides to take what it wants or destroys what it wants.
Is it viewed negatively among the tribal elders to shoot and kill one of these things?
We will name it, you know, shoot it in the leg or shoot up in the air, throw a rock at it. If you throw a rock at it, it'll immediately turn around and walk away. It won't stare at you or any, or it won't charge you. You immediately throw a rock at it. But if it comes closer, if it keeps coming around, that's when you name it. You know, you shoot at the leg. And then we don't try to kill it.
So you think of them as they're sort of similar to people, like an ancient race of people. Relic hominids would be the way that we'd say it in Western science. They're like some kind of a caveman type creature or something like that, that are still just, you know, not to make a play on names there with your name, caveman, but that they've been, you know, they've been out there living in that style of life for forever, as far as we know. They were there when you guys showed up, and you guys have been there for a tremendously long time.
Yes.
So I got these two brothers, and they're having nonstop problems with these things. I mean, they're getting charged up to their... one of the brothers was charged up into the garage, ran inside, and when they came out, there was muddy footprints, and it looked like he had peed in his garage as it was chasing him. But these guys have been chased several times by these things. They claim they see them all the time, day and night. And they go through and describe different ones and tell you, well, this one looks more ape-like. This one definitely has more of a human appearance. And they talk about one that has really long hair. They say he seems to direct traffic. And I asked him what he meant by that. And he goes, well, like the military, like special forces, there's one guy in charge. That's kind of what they do. But they can't get these things to go away. They've lit their property up. You know, they've tried just about everything to make these things go away. And the last resort, you know, we've been talking about was shooting one of them. Do you think there'd be retaliation, though, for shooting one of these things, even if you maim it?
If you maim it, it goes away, and it thinks twice of coming around again. But there are, like we say, there are other relatives out there, affairs. And they're the ones that will come around and try and do what the other one that got shot, they'll try to do that, and they'll be try more forceful like that. If you shoot one of them and they lay dead there, then that's different. That's anybody basic instinct, vengeance, you know.
Is there anything you'd recommend to these guys as opposed to shooting it?
One thing that I do is I pee around my house all the time. I mean, my significant other be yelling at me, hey, there's a restroom inside. And I be peeing all over, you know, making my boundary. I do that. Even after it rains, I pee outside. And that makes them more hesitant to come in. Like if I want them to come in from maybe the south, the north, or all like that, I pee only on the east and the west. And then sure enough, they'll come in from there. And I set up traps or something that would make me know that they're around. I put up a whole bunch of them. My house is like strategically set up for when these things come around, when they bump into something, when they slide one of the shovels down, or they pick it up, or they step on one of the rakes all of a sudden. And it's not usually like anything that the adults, their adults would do. They know, the adults know, but it's the younger ones that are kind of
clumsy. Right, make mistakes.
Yeah, they're the ones that step on the rake or step on the shovel, and that's when they yell out, or what they do is quince, and then that's when you know. And they think that when they quince, they think that it's real low, and you could hear it. Oh, it'll wake you up. It'll be like, kind of loud. It's kind of like that.
Has anyone on the reservation shot one of these things?
We've only heard about the one that got shot way up in the mountain as it was following the whole family back.
Can you tell us that story?
They went out to gather firewood for the winter, and there were some guys, the brothers and cousins, which usually somewhere around five. They went out about 5 miles away from their house, and here it didn't holler or it didn't make noises or anything. They just noticed that there was a husky that was around, and that's the reason why they left after they were almost done with their firewood pickup. And they left, and going down the road, they found out that this thing was still following them, and they were going towards closer to their house. So then they just stopped. One guy says, hey, you know, we don't want to lead that thing back to the house. So he took out his 30-06 and with the scope, and when this thing came out in the open, it just plugged them over right there. And they called the rangers and the police, and from there on, they took care of it. They just told them, you know, you never seen this. From there, they were told not to talk about it. It never happened, and nobody would believe them because the body, there's no body.
Right, no body. That got hauled away.
That's how they do things. That's why we didn't maim them and, you know, make them not come around. Yeah, it discourages them. And peeing is also one thing that, you know, make sure that it's a male that's peeing around rather than a female. If it's a female, then, you know, you're just saying, hey, come on in. You know, there's a woman over here. So
yeah, they like the ladies more than they should. Yeah. Do you think that rock salt might be a good answer for just discouraging them? Because it's got a lot more pain up front, but a lot less permanent damage on the tail end of it.
That would be good. The other thing that I noticed that they try to avoid is flashing lights. Not like Christmas lights. Like there was this electrician guy that told me, hey, you know, there's this thing that comes around. At first he asked me to investigate and all of that. Him and his wife and his kids, and I put up my stealth cam up, and we got some pictures, and it was around, yeah. So it even bothered the stealth cam, and I showed them the picture, and they're like, "What can I do? What can I do out here?" Because he didn't have no electricity; he only ran on solar and generated. So I told him, hey, you know, how about hook up one of those really intense flashing bulbs up on top of your house at both ends? Sure enough, I guess he got the parts and hooked it up to his solar, and all night long that thing just, you know, flashed, pop.
So what is it, caveman? Like a strobe light? Like a fast strobe?
Yeah. Like just like maybe a delay of 10 seconds or 15 seconds, 13 or 30 seconds. That's what made them, you know, not come around no more. The real intense ones.
That's interesting.
Like
that. Yeah, blowing their night vision really freaks them the hell out, because they've got all the advantage over us in the dark. And if all of a sudden they can't see properly, they want nothing to do with it.
Well, it made me think, as Caveman's talking, Duke, that, you know, we talk about lasers in the past and how lasers strips your night vision away. And if you've ever been on the, you know, they have those stupid fireworks that do the strobe light. After that thing gets done, man, I'm like blind for about 30 seconds. I can't see anything around me. And I almost wonder if what Caveman's talking about does the exact same thing to them, to where they can't see.
You know how those strobe lights that that are like warning lights for these industrial fire hazard warnings. Those are the ones I'm talking about. If you put a clear thing on top of it to cover the bulb itself, that thing will go out about 500 feet real easy. Just boom. And then it goes, recharges again while it's hissing, and then, you know, it all just depends on how much of a delay you put in there to get the best brightness out of it. And that's what the electrician did, and this thing never came back around.
So, Caveman, are you kind of the go-to guy? Let's say I was living on the reservation and I had these things around my property. Do I call you, or who? How does that work on a reservation?
It all depends. People are starting to find out that I would investigate around the house, around the residence, and find out if it's really coming around. I'll sit out there for, you know, all night and all of that, or half the night. If I see one just right then and there, yeah, you know, it's just, yeah, I'll give him, you know, some options. From there on, you know, whatever they can work with, that's what they do, you know. So, and then there's Brenda Harris, my buddy, you know, she's a sweet little lady. They go to her too, and whoever knows about them. And then there's other researchers that they go to also that are around there. There's a lot of them that have a lot of knowledge, and I'm not the only one that has encounters here on the New Mexico side. There's a whole bunch of groups that are here that do their investigations, and there's people are, you know, these guys are knowledgeable the way that they talk about it also.
Caveman, let me ask you two questions. I'll throw the first one at you. from people's descriptions in the area, can you give us a general description on what people are seeing from the face to the height to the weight? What are people out there on the reservation seeing?
Sometimes they would say that it's on all fours. They would, some of them, they just see it on all fours. It's just a man that, you know, crouches around. That's what they say. And then some of them just call them skinwalkers, but we know what they are. You know, kind of we just tell them. And then the height of these things, it all depends on the region. The ones that are, like, in the lower elevation where I live, somewhere around 5,600. A little bit scrawny and just a little bit small, kind of like maybe 6 feet to 7 feet. And some of them are, you know, they range up to 8 feet. They're small, and they're kind of slender also. And they walk upright, and when they're walking upright, and they're standing, they're very straight. They're in a straight backbone, and just like a kind of like trying to describe it, just a straight man, just the tall man, just walking real straight. That's how they walk. And then the ones that that are in the higher elevation, like the mountains, they're huge. You know, they're very maybe 10 to 12 feet. They're the muscular ones, and that's the two different ones of what I seen. And when these guys come down for their feast in the local gardens that people, you know, plant corn and watermelon. There's a whole bunch of people that do that. They go out there, and then they're the ones that, you know, raid them gardens and all of that. And here, it's like that. And then amongst them, then there's that wolf-looking one. So, and that one walks upright, too. And some of these huskies try to disguise themselves as that also. And that's why you would see sometimes, I've seen them, you know, some other people's photos that look like somebody else is looking behind something that has ears, you know, and that is kind of dark and like that. If so they wear pelts, you know, they wear disguises. Is policing, but the actual one, and what I'm talking about is the dog man. That one walks around, be like that, and sometimes I've seen them both together. I've heard that, you know, they don't like each other and have wars and all of that, but I've seen them together and all of that, and that's, I've seen those with the ones that wear the pelts also.
So you're describing dogmen wearing, like, pelts?
No, the Hustine. The Hustine is the Bigfoot. The whole name is Hustine Zikui, and in Navajo.
Oh, I gotcha.
And so the Hustine is easy to pronounce, and Zikui is kind of, like, hard for people to pronounce. So I just keep it at Hustine. Really, Hustine means man, you know, man and... either respected man, it could be a leader and all of that, but the way that these elders say that Hustine Zikui, that would mean that, you know, the man from the hairy man from the mountain.
In that so sense, the name head man comes first, and then the describer of what kind of man you're talking about is what comes afterwards.
Yeah, so I just cut the name in half because people understand that more. I'm talking, you know, it's just like saying the man to the English non-speaking Navajo and like that. I don't mean to be disrespectful, but I just try to make it more simple. It's just like saying Sasquatch.
Yeah, you know, I get what you're saying. Do you think that these creatures have ill intent when you come across them?
Some of them do. Like I said, somebody else would have maimed it somewhere else, and they will have ill feelings towards the next human that goes that they see. If even just being in the area, and like for an example, I went down below to where the water, you know, the San Juan River is, and I wanted to cut some tree limbs to make a corral. And here I started my chainsaw and started I cut down three trees and decided to take a break because I dragged them all out and all of that all by myself. So I decided to take a break and went off to the site. And here over, you know, the trees are like maybe 30 feet high. There's, you know, it's very thick. You know, I was only cutting out the ones that were sticking out. And here on that opposite side, there were big branches about maybe 3 inch or 4 inch diameter by 4 feet that flew over the trees. And about then the trees were at like 30 feet up in the air. And I took off out of there and I packed up. So, you know, they might have been sleeping, and I turned on my chainsaw and, you know, woke them up, and it's like saying, hey, you know, get out of here.
How far do you think that that tree branch flew? I mean, that was a sizable piece of wood, too.
Right where I chainsawed left, that's where it flew. And I was lucky to have walked away when I, you know, cut that one down, and I left that one. I just picked up my chainsaw and took off. And anyhow, I was thinking about it as I, you know, set off. And I tried it at a different place. I was like, okay, you know, let me try it. So I picked up, I chainsawed one, and one of the branches about the same length and the same diameter. I threw it up, and it just hit about maybe 12 feet up in the air, and then it came back down. I didn't even not even clear that those trees. I tried several times, even spinning with it, like you're trying to throw a disc, you know, one of those discus. And here, I didn't have no luck.
Yeah, you hear plenty of reports of them lobbing huge things at people when they get mad at them, and the distances and the heights they can throw some of this stuff. It's terrifying. It's like you've got a medieval catapult over there lobbing stuff at you.
There was a guy that called me, one of my buddies. He goes on top of the mountain too, you know, to the sheep camp. And here one time he calls me and he says, hey, I was taking my sheep back into the corral, and I was kind of like out in the open, and here there's a cliff off to the side about maybe 500 feet, he said. And here, first, I saw rocks that were being thrown at my feet, and then it started to go towards me. And these rocks were somewhere around 7 to 6 inches being thrown way out there, and it almost hit one almost onto my horse's face. I looked up there, and this thing was standing on top of that cliff. He laughed at me after he sees that my horse kind of bucks with me. He said, "So that's what they do."
The Sasquatch laughed at you?
Yeah, lad, they laugh. Whoa, whoa, ho, 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 ho. You see that?
That's interesting. I've only heard that one other time. What I've been getting a lot lately on the show is people who, especially hunters, the last couple shows. The person hears what sounds like a child laughing and like a conversation going on, but they can't understand the conversation. It sounds like Russian backwards. I mean, it's just real, very hard to understand what, but it's some sort of conversation. And as they'll walk towards the sound, they'll get growled at and huffed at. And so it makes me wonder, you know, if these things really do have a true language. I realize every animal has a language. I mean, I should videotape the squirrels out back when they chatter back and forth to each other like they're having a conversation. So I realize they do. But in this sense, it was a real odd encounter because there was laughter. One was trying to talk over the other one. It's almost like a bunch of kids until he walked up on it and it started growling at him. And he backed off really quick. He said that was no kids.
Yeah, I got an example for both of you guys here from my own personal experience. I was taking care of one of my friends He had an African green parrot, and I had to take care of about a month, and the parrot's name was Chico. And Chico, as young as he was, and he was a young parrot, already had like 7 or 8 different things that he could say. And he could actually string together what these things meant, apparently. And here's an example. He didn't like the cat that I had. The cat would be miserable and try and torture him in his little perch during the day. So he would pay attention when the cat was sleeping, and he would try and get back at the cat. And he was once watching the cat laying down there sleeping. He goes, flutters down to the ground, or the floor, slowly trudges across the floor up to the cat's tail, bites the cat on the tail, and flutters back up to his perch as fast as he can. Well, of course, that wakes the cat up. Parrot's got a hell of a bite. Cat's freaking out, running in circles, wondering what attacked it. Now, here's the point that's important. The parrot lands back up on his perch and goes,
fuck you.
He knew exactly what he was saying. He knew exactly what that meant. He doesn't know a language. He's just been observing the humans around him and has picked up what these sounds that they're making potentially might mean. And you know a Bigfoot's got to be at least as damn smart as a parrot is.
We always, when we hear stuff like that, we mimic it. We really don't have like words like grunt or golf, like laughing with real low. We really don't have words like that we use out here. We usually mimic it. Like it would say cough or like that.
Mm-hmm.
Or ones that we're throwing rocks. Me and my nephews in here, they one walks out, left at a horse, and then my nephew threw a rock into the bushes again, and it kind of just, while it's walking away, it kind of like just looked to the side, and he goes, and then my nephew kind of got scared, and he says, what did he say? And I was like, he said, if you throw another rock, I'm going to eat all three of you.
Probably good translation. That'd be a poem, my guess would be for it.
And yeah, like, they do. With rocks, some of them, they do talk in high pitches. They say that, not more, and then they say that. There's a lot of in. That's the way, you know, that we mimic it. We notice like that, and there's a lot of nih, you know, like that. I think that's what you're talking about. But that's where it's Russian when you say
I'm often wondered if they do have some kind of language that they're using amongst each other in order to convey what's going on, and if they have, like, actually the same sort of language in, you know, all over North America, or if there's little variations from place to place. You know, it seems to me like...
Well, you know what was strange? Not to cut you off, Duke. You know what was strange? Those guys I had on, you and I talked in depth about this. One of the things the guy said was, rarely will you ever hear them speak.
Mm-hmm.
In this particular location, caveman I'm talking about, he was saying rarely will you ever hear them actually speak. He said there's a lot of pops, a lot of teeth chatters or pops. He almost wonders if they're talking at a lower frequency we can't hear. And he said the only time you ever heard some of the stuff that you're describing is when the really big one shows up. He said he doesn't really necessarily do animal sounds. He'll do more of, sounds like a Russian talking backwards, that type of vocalization. Have you heard that before?
I've never heard that before. I've listened to like the high pitch, like that. I've heard that one, and then like the lower, the one I just did a while ago. That I've listened to that.
We seem to get reports around here of the people hearing the higher pitched ones because they tie it in with. Chinese mine workers that were, like, killed in the mines around here or something, and say that there's an abandoned mine over there and the ghosts are haunting it. It's those Chinese miners, and you can hear them chattering away, talking to each other in Chinese at night off in the woods and stuff. You know, it's like, okay. That sounds pretty much like the same thing you're describing there, caveman.
That sounds, you know, how I, you know, came upon several of them, you know, in conversations was, you know, just like you said, there's all these caves around here. And here, you would hear them, you know, just kind of like stand off to the side. I don't even would want to go up to a cave, you know.
Yeah, it's tough to get me to go near them in the daytime, not anywhere near them at night, that's for sure.
I only go through there during the daytime, and, you know, when I listen, then it would be way in the background. You go, and then all of a sudden you hear, ah! And then it goes silent.
I almost wonder if that's what some of these witnesses that are coming on are confusing it for, because the way they describe it is like two female children talking. And that's kind of what you're doing, Caveman. I mean, I almost wondered if that's kind of what they're hearing, that real higher pitch, and they're alluding it to being, you know, they're in their mind, they're perceiving it to be a female when it may not be.
Yeah, something to hear. But for me, I would say that it's like little kids just trying to stay quiet. Maybe the husky team is all trying to go to sleep and the little kids are talking and,
one of the big ones finally gives them the notice to shut up. It's time to go to sleep.
Yeah.
You kind of alluded to it earlier, talking about the cover-up and how the guys were told, hey, you never saw anything. You guys weren't here. Yeah, obviously, there's some sort of cover-up going on. Why do you think it's being covered up?
There is something going on by the government. There's a lot more paperwork that came up. Even to grasp land, you know, to get to lease some land on the reservation, you know, there's a lot more paperwork that you have to turn in into the local government offices, and the way that the documentaries that I looked at were not, you know, of Hustings or anything like that. They were like the BLM, and also the scientists that say that there's no more aqueducts and all of that. They say that they're studying all of that, and all of that coming from way down south New Mexico all the way up to the borders of Idaho. And some of these people are being told to move out because all of a sudden there's a endangered plant that grew up right where they used to graze, or where they graze all the time. And these ranchers were saying that. And then the other scientists were saying that the water within that area, that range, you know, it's a big, vast thing that they were talking about, that the fish are disappearing and all of that, and people that used to go fishing are told not to go fishing there no more, and it goes all the way up. So it's something that, you know, that is there, and then the reason why that they, to me, my own opinion is they're bringing them in. One time there's a guy that was telling me, one of the rangers, They told him that they were bringing in a grizzly bear from, I think it was Oregon. And that grizzly bear was ferocious up in that area. And they were bringing it down into the reservation. I was like, well, what about us? I said, what if it eats us?
No kidding.
Yeah, we're hungry. Well,
like, I'd be like, wait a minute. You're bringing a ferocious bear, and you're going to drop it in our community and wish us all Godspeed as you guys take off. I mean, this sounds like, maybe it's a Native American in me, but this is outrageous.
It's oh, God. Some of the crap they try and get away with is just boggle the mind.
So there's a lot of new things that they come up with, you know, how they, like what I'm saying, they ask you, like, in, I think it was like 5 pages of your plan to have land, you know, set aside for you. You fill out all that up. You forecast it, how the the bushes are going to be at? Is it going to bother some other wildlife that's in the area? And it's like, you just want to put, I don't know, but I want this land. And yeah. I want to farm it, stuff like that. And I want to use it. Yes, I will tell you what kind of plant that I want to put in and let my livestock graze on that one. They make you plan for like 10 years to 20 years. And we don't, nobody sees it. The 20 years, what if, you know, the main thing that people's excuse is, well, then what if I die before then? Is this still going to happen within the years that I forecasted what I'm going to do? So people just leave it, and then here all these bushes grow up, and there's a lot more bushes that have sprung up because of all this government thing, study going on, and all of that too. So, and then that's where the huskies, they roam around within those bushes.
They're making the environment better for them too. They got more thickets and stuff to hide in.
Yes, they there's a lot more thickets.
I'll tell you something that's going to piss you off, but you probably already know this. I've spoken to three different government officials now at this point that say they drop these things off near reservations or very poor communities. And the reason why they do that is because, A, no one's going to believe the Native Americans, and B, no one's going to believe some poor old white hillbilly living out in the middle of the woods saying he ran into a Sasquatch. They're going to, you know, call him a moonshiner. They're going to call him this. They're going to call him that. You know, that to me is, it's just completely outrageous. Outrageous policy, outrageous behavior.
That's what I'm talking about. Them saying that they're going to bring in the grizzly from way up north. And it was supposed to have been, you know, relocated because it was ferocious. And it's that story right there.
Hey, there's plenty of ferocious grizzlies right here in Montana. You could just leave it here. That's what they always do with them here. We have grizzly problems. They just relocate them up to the Bob Marshall Wilderness behind the 1,000-foot-high wall that's 22 miles long, and they don't come back again. They don't need to ship them all the way down there to New Mexico. We got a refuge for them right here. There's no reason to ship it down there. If it gets loose again, we'll make steaks out of it. No problem.
Navajos don't eat bears.
Yeah, neither do Apaches. Apaches don't eat them either. And I don't know why. Do you know why?
The bear is like a real close relative.
Yeah, that's what the Apaches say too.
It's like your grandpa.
Yeah, if you ever skinned one, they look a lot like a human. So not to gruesome and graphic, but
I knew the Apaches were against it too, and it's what you said, caveman. It's exactly the reason why they're against it.
You know, I'm just happy that we got to cover most of the stuff that we talked about here. It was nice to hear the actual the Navajo perspective on the stuff that's going on around there. And it was frankly kind of frightening that Caveman can back up some of the stuff that you and me have been hearing, Wes, that, you know, again, it's some of this weird stuff that we keep getting told from other people, and it all starts matching up. And the more that happens, the creepier it gets. And, you know, so on the one hand, I think it was just great that we had Caveman come on here to share some of that information with us. But on the other hand, it creeps me the hell out. You know, there's some of this stuff that we find out that we really hope it isn't true. We don't want it to be true. And then you start finding out that it might be true. And it's like, yay, I don't feel good about this.
Well, and it's just like, and we don't have to go into dogmans. You know, some of the reports you were talking about, caveman, about being pulled out of the house, half-eaten, or arm ripped off. There was a report I've been looking into in Michigan, and I'm kind of getting it through a third party that's involved with it, and he knows, he went to school with the sheriff, and so he got to talking to him, and he was telling him a little story. Kept asking him, was it a wolf that got in there? Nope, wasn't a wolf. Was it a bear? Nope, wasn't a bear. Was it a mountain lion? Nope, wasn't a mountain lion. And what's interesting is when they asked him, when he really drilled this guy down for answers, the guy came out and actually said a bipedal canine. He didn't say dog man. He said a bipedal canine attacked and killed the residents of the home. And I think one of the residents, not to get too gruesome, but I think one of the residents' arms were out in the driveway. One of the legs was like a mile down the road. I mean, it had just ripped them apart.
Like I said, some of them I've seen with the hot team. That's the one that Carl also, Ma'i, the big wolf. It's really the name for the wolf group, and it's just the wolf name is Ma'i. Yeah, the big wolf. The two names on there, you know, Ma'i, which is wolf. But then there's another letter, you know, a word that goes afterwards. They have seen also, which is Ma'i, on the house of the big wolf. They call it that. And some of these are like the hut that the hot teams built. And they go in there, and you know, they're like that. So we have seen, me and my brothers have seen those down on the Arizona part, and that's the one that would walk around late at night. Also, you know, it wasn't just only the husky that would walk around. My grandpa used to call it horse face. Don't go down below, down the wash, because the horse face guy would catch you.
Horse face, that sounds like a description of what I would call a gugwe, the Bigfoot type that's got the snout on it, the muzzle on it.
That's what we call them, and it does have ears. It does, and it has a husky body, and it's more wolf-looking because of the kind of like the hair, kind of split back, just the way you would see a wolf. As the hair starts on the forehead starts going back, that's the description that I have.
Is that what you think you got the picture of in that one photo I got from you that I had the center cropped and zoomed?
That's the one that was looking through the window at me. And besides, I have both Hasin and the dog man.
Do you think that Dogman is a complete separate species over Sasquatch?
I believe it's separate species. It's something different. That one we, you know, in our tribe, that's more animal, and the Husky is more man.
Yeah, it's interesting you say that. You know, some of the tribes I've talked to here in Washington State, they'll swear up and down we don't have them in Washington State. But what they will, I did have a tribal elder tell me, if you do come across one, shoot it. Don't think twice, shoot it. And he had nothing good to say about the dog man.
Yeah.
Hope everybody can stay safe down there on the res, because you got what looks like a perfect storm of bad things coming up here with the weather the way it's been. There isn't going to be as much crops as there normally should be anyway, from what I understand down there. A lot of the fields that usually have something growing in don't have anything growing in. And you've got the Hostians down there not having enough food and wanting to scavenge for it. And then you got the wild card of, well, the government's maybe dropping off more of them in the area and whatnot. And you had just told me here not very long ago that you thought that there was a general increase in the population going on.
Well, it looks like we lost Caveman. Duke, thanks for coming on, though, and sharing that. Caveman seems like one of those guys you could probably do 3 or 4 or 5 shows on, just the different encounters he's had, the experience he has, and we just talked about 1% of stuff he's dealt with tonight. And so I'd love to have him back on the show. Thank you so much for bringing him to the show.
Oh, you're very welcome, Wes, and I feel the same way about talking to the Caveman. He's just got so much information, and he's so interested in this, and he's had a lifelong, you know, set of experiences that go along with it. And unlike most of us, he grew up just thinking it was like, there's one of these things that live out here, and then progressed and learned a lot more about it and became to the point where it was, you know, something that was going on fairly regular. He didn't even hardly touch on this, but he's got him still messing around at his property constantly. 2-3 days ago, there was a couple of them up there that took a bag of horse feed that he had, 55 pounds of it. They left the bag there, but there was nothing left in the bag when the sun came up again. So this is just an ongoing thing for him. And I really treasure talking to the guy because, we have so much fun sharing information with each other and stuff that I just have a great time. And I figured that your fans would enjoy it too. And it would be nice to get another perspective on what may actually be going on down there on the Navajo Res. And, so I'm glad you could find the time to have him on your show, Wes.
And thank you, Duke, for coming on, man. I really appreciate it. Next week might have you back. Got a couple of really interesting shows. Can't talk too much about them at the moment, but I'd like to have you back for them because you might find them very, very interesting.
Well, it's always a possibility. If you want to drag me on there with you, I'd be happy to come on and help you go through the whole thing. And don't forget about Conspiracy Corner either. I'm pushing west to try and get part two of the Base 211 one done, you guys. So don't freak out. We'll get it done at some point.
Yeah, we may end up having to redo it due to my laptop issues. So that's where it was at too, saved.
Yeah.
So that's frustrating. But we'll find a way. We'll get it back up.
Well, I've got all the video and everything that we need to put it together again, and we really need to do another audio part for it to go from where we left off and explain it from there back to where we were at, where they were in Operation High Jump in Antarctica, and then what happened from there.
And if you get a chance, check out World Bigfoot Radio on YouTube. Also, SasquatchChronicles.com. Check out the image I posted back on August 4th. It was sent to me. I put a little blurb in there. I'm not claiming it's a Sasquatch by any means. Interesting image captured. So if you get a free moment, check that out. Jump over to YouTube. Subscribe to Duke at World Bigfoot Radio. Until next time, Duke.
Take care, Wes. Love you, brother. Take care, everybody out there.
Thanks, Duke. And that's it for tonight, everyone. Remember, if you've had an encounter, shoot me an email. Wes@SasquatchChronicles.com. Look for all the Sasquatch Chronicle gear right around September 1st. Until next time, everyone, have a good night. Spirit.